Hey, horse people.
Got a couple videos on a saddle pad. And the video was, my horse is scared of saddle pad. I put it on, it bucked. Now I'm restarting and I'm trying to get the horse used to saddle pad. What do I need to do? The other question on one of my other videos was, my horse is scared of the hose. Remember that video? If you go back and watch, I forgot which one, it might be Serenity. But when I put the hose in a bucket, the horse scared. It freaked out, whatever the terminology was. I'm gonna show you how to freak out a horse by doing it wrong, and then I'll show you how to use pressure release and timing and rhythm to get the horse to relax and ignore this. And I've done this on several sacking out videos. It's just another sacking out with a blanket. So my horses know what a saddle blanket is. I ride them both and I put it on them every day. But watch them both react when I walk over there like they're already trained, because I'm not aware of what I'm doing. Watch them react. I'm doing it wrong. Oh my God, my horse is scared. Rick, my horse is scared of a saddle blanket. I've never had a saddle blanket on him before. That was because of the way I did it, people. I jacked him up because I went over there like they know they're trained, therefore I don't have to pay attention. You always have to be aware of what you're doing when your horse reacts. These horses reacted because of what I did, not because they're scared of the blanket, because of what I did. I'm sorry, Mr. So now, I got an excuse, my horse scared of a blanket. See how Mr. T is? Oh, I need to send him to a trainer. He's scared of a blanket. He's not scared of a blanket, he's scared of me acting like a dummy with the blanket. That's why when I blame people and you wanna go, oh, it's not me, Rick, because I did everything you did. No, you didn't. You did it wrong because the horse told me. These horses told me I did it wrong. So now I have to undo what I want. That's another problem. Well, I did this and I really screwed up my horse. Can I ever fix him? Of course you can fix them. I can screw them up quick and I can fix them quick. I'm gonna fix Mr. T real quick here. Move his feet, make sure he's paying attention to me. Little resistance, come. Throw a blanket on him, take it off. See, his head kind of went up? I've gotta give him release. What people do, look at Mr. T's head. He's like, what the? He's scared of the blanket. Oh my God, he's scared of the blanket. Can you not see how I cause that, people? You need to be aware of what you're doing. When I don't make it a big deal, the horse won't make it a big deal. Sorry, Mr. T, I know. It's like, Dad, why are you being a crazy guy? Mwah! I know. So now I'm not gonna make a big deal. I'm gonna give him pressure. I'm gonna give him release. I'm gonna do things that he's comfortable with. I'm gonna take him back to a place that he's comfortable and he knows and he's secure. I'm gonna stop his focus on his blanket, get his focus on me. Head, head. Good. I'm gonna rub his eyes softly. I'm gonna remind him that we're buds. Now we're gonna do the blanket again. Less of a reaction. Why is he less of a reaction? Because I'm an extraordinary horse whisperer and training mofo. No, because I did it right. I gave him release and I let him know this is normal. He's not sneaking. He's being confident. He's being smooth. This is smooth. That's smooth and non-threatening. This is sneaky and predator. Oh, oh my God! He's scared of the blanket! Poor Mr. D. I know. He's like, Dad, I'm sorry. I don't know what I did. I'm sorry. Can you see how if you do it right, the horse will do it right? If you do it wrong, the horse will do it wrong. The question that I got was about the blanket. Was he still scared of the blanket? And I'm starting him over. And how do I get him used to it? Because he's still scared. He's still scared because you're still scared. That's why. You need to take this blanket on and off him every way. Let it fall. Let it drop. Rub him. Groom him. Do it fast, do it slow, put it on high, put it on low, let it fall. You need to do everything so this horse says, you know what? I don't care about the blanket. This blanket ain't nothing. I don't really like what Dad's doing. I'm not sure why he's doing it, but I gotta accept it and I can't say no. I gotta throw the blanket on high. I gotta sneak it on low. I gotta slide it forward, I gotta slide it backwards, I gotta hit him with it. Wow, that's amazing. Less than 5 minutes ago, this horse was scared of a blanket because he was abused and oxygen deprived as a baby, and it wasn't his fault. He was neglected. And I was trying to help him, and he was just scared of the blanket. People, quit putting things on your horse. It's you. You're insecure. You're scared. You're worried. You screwed up, and you don't know how to get over it yourself. You don't know how to forgive yourself. You don't know how to go, you know what? I'm human. I screwed up. Let me make it better for the horse. I can't keep making a horse pay because I'm sorry, or I'm worried, or I love him, or I don't want to scare him. Horses get scared. Mr. T got scared. Buddy got scared. Guess what? They got scared, and they got unscared in the same fur they were in when they got scared. I don't care. You have to ignore things and quit making excuses. So blanket. This horse needs to go here. I need to blanket both sides. I need to hit him with the belly. I need to chase flies with it. I need to rub him. I need to rub his nose. I need to rub his ears. Oh, he didn't like the ears. Guess what? Now we got to do the ears. Oh my God, he's scared of his ears and he was abused. Somebody clipped his, and you can't touch his ear. Don't touch it, because he'll get scared. You know what? He'll get unscared. All right. That's sacking out horse blanket for dummies 10.7. Hi, buddy. It's like, I'm glad you're missing Mr. T. Same thing with this bag. This is like the hose comment. This bag is not scaring a horse. And I sack them out all the time. But if I walk over here crazy, I'm going to scare them. Now, I'm going to walk over right so you can see how when you do it right, they won't get scared first. Because somebody's going to go, well, you scared them both the first time, and that's because they were taught to do that. And that's not... Okay, I scared them first on the blanket. Now I'm going to scare them second on the bag. And I'm probably going to get a little reaction. I haven't done this in a while. But you know what? Oh, well. Okay, that's a horse after 30 days of training at $700 for 30 days. That's what you get. Okay? Now, when you bring me your horse and say your horse scared of the blanket and I want you to pay me for 30 days, here's how I'm going to approach them. Are these horses? Oh, yeah, they're scared. Oh, man, look at that. See, yeah, that horse is scared. You got to really be careful this. He's... Come here. Oh, yeah, he's scared. Man, he's scared of this bag. Now, you know what? If you pay me $700, I'll get your horse like you just saw. How you approach the horse. If I approach him with not paying attention and people go, well, you've seen this bag 100 times, doesn't matter. If I'm preoccupied and I walk up on this horse and I'm doing my own thing and I'm not talking to him and looking at him, and they're gonna get nervous because I'm not being aware of what I'm doing. I'm making them nervous. If I'm aware of what I'm doing, if I'm paying attention, I'm gonna walk up, let them know, hey, we're gonna do some bag training here, bud. I need you to come over here, come here. Drop your head for me. Thank you. Give him some comfort. Now we're going to do some sacking out with rhythm. This is rhythm. In and out. Pressure, release. Pressure, release. Pressure, release. Pressure with rhythm. Release with rhythm. Pressure with rhythm. Release with rhythm. No rhythm. Okay, he sacked out. That's good. He didn't move. He didn't pull. Can you people see how crazy it is when people write me questions? I'm like, it's not the horse. It's you. I can make a horse look good. I can make him look bad. That's why when you take your horse to a trainer and you're like, oh, this trainer said this horse was the wildest horse he ever saw and he's going to take 60 days. Well, good. You're a dummy. Okay? Let me sack these guys out and get them over this fear that I created. Because I ruined them. Now I gotta fix them. Probably take me 30 days and $500 to fix them. Let me fix them. Buddy, are you ruined? Let me fix Buddy. He's a wild, crazy horse. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness, Buddy. Oh, Buddy, you need a trainer. Never walk behind a horse with a bag. It scares him. If I walk like this, it scares him. If I walk normal, he don't care.
Mr. T, are you getting scared?
All right, I got to get Mr. T a little more. Now, see, I could stop here, and that would be okay, but Mr. T showed me that he's not comfortable with this bag. I don't want Mr. T confusing that maybe he stopped because I'm scared. I don't want to leave a horse with that mis... I always have to be aware of what did the horse get out of this. Right now, Mr. T could possibly say, you know what, when I put my head up, he kind of stopped. I'm kind of glad. Next time he does this, I'm going to put my head up. No, I want to make sure without a doubt he understands he is not stopping the pressure. I'm stopping the pressure when I want to with control. So I'm going to give him pressure and I'm going to stop it the way I want to. No head. I stopped. No confusion here. There's no doubt in Mr. T's mind. The only thing he might do is go, man, when I tie it up in my stomach and get nervous and almost poop, he stops with the bag. I don't care if he associates that. I don't want him associating or confusing when I went like this, he stopped. I want to stop when I'm sure that he knows I stopped the pressure. But he raises his head. He does not get release. He has to play. He has to mess around. I have to help him because I can't teach him the right answer over here. I have to help him to come to the pressure. And now I stop. I don't want him confusing. He made me stop. I want it always clear on my horse. I stopped because you gave me the right answer. What's the right answer? Don't tell me no. Don't resist. Don't raise your head. Don't show fear. You can be scared. You just can't act scared, run off, and do your instinctual thing. I'm going to give him some help. I'm going to release the help and let him know. If I don't touch that rope and I come over here, Buddy may raise his head and confuse. See his head went up? I don't even want his head going up that much. But I didn't give him help. Now I'm going to help him so his head doesn't raise. And it only takes a finger. It only takes this much pressure to give him a little direction. But I have to help him and make it clear what the right answer is. Buddy, the right answer is for you to keep your head right here for me and let me rub. And when you do, I'll let go of the rope and I'll stop rubbing. Answer's clear. You got to break it down and kind of think on a horse's level. They're not complex thinkers. They can't formulate like we can. Mr. T's head's a little high, so just when I stop, just to make sure he doesn't confuse his head's high with release. Head. Now I know he got the message I wanted to send. All right, what's the time on there?
12 minutes. How? Almost 13 minutes.
13?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, good. Here's what I wanted to, a couple things I wanted to cover here. On my, I talked about one of my videos. I did an experiment with a kid in a store, and what I did with pressure and release is a little kid, his mom was right here in front of me, and I was standing here. And before I walked up, the little kid was maybe, if this is his mom, this pole's his mom, he was about this far away from his mom, digging into candy and messing around. Well, as soon as I walked up and he saw a stranger, he scooted right over to mom between her legs and looked at me, just like a baby herd animal would do. It went back to safety and comfort. The kid was at a point, I only find safety and comfort with mom. Now, you wouldn't beat the kid and say, oh, your mom's sour. Get away from him. The kid's responding at the level he's at. So when the kid went over to his mom and kind of looked at me, I thought it was kind of cute that he gave to my pressure. I walked up, pressure. He gave to my pressure and went and gave himself release by going to his mom. He gave himself release of the pressure. So what I did is I turned my back to him, and I watched him. And as I turned my back to him, he felt that release of pressure. He knew I wasn't watching him, and he moved away from mom. And he got a little closer to candy, but he was watching me. And so instead of giving him a lot of pressure, I just looked at him. Boom, as soon as I looked at him, he felt that pressure, he went right back to mom. Why is this guy looking at me? Is he gonna take me? Is he a weirdo? What's going on? And mom's sitting here digging through her purse, and he's like through her legs, and she's like, what are you doing? What's going on? And I'm sitting here just playing with this kid, making him draw away, and I'm pushing him back. I'm drawing him away. So I did it without looking at him. I just did it with my body. I went like this. As soon as he moved a little away, I didn't look at him. I looked straight ahead, and I turned and faced my body. He didn't go all the way to mom. He went to a lake on the outside and stopped. He got a little bit closer. He got that confident. He was learning. He was figuring out, I can get myself released. Do I have to do this? Maybe I don't have to be scared. Maybe I don't have to be between mom's legs. Maybe this guy isn't a threat. But he didn't know. He was figuring out. He was doing just like horses do. And if people would see this herd and instinctual and how we build our bodies and grow, you'd see a lot in horses. A lot of people say horses like teenagers because they're always testing. They're always seeing what they can get away with. They kind of think they know it all. They're big. They kind of push people around. They kind of fill their oats. That's kind of what teenagers do, especially teenage boys, because they get that testosterone and they think they're king shit. Well, you know what? Sometimes they need a boot in the ass. Sometimes they need double barrels to knock them back down and go, you ain't as bad as you think you are. That's what horses are. So sometimes I've got to let Mr. T know he's still scared of that blanket. Now, would I leave a blanket here and walk away? Probably not. Because what happens, and I say this a lot in a lot of my videos, you have to always make sure the horse remembers that you're on a saddle. People goes, Rick, you're an idiot. Of course he knows I'm on a saddle. I'm sitting up there, he feels my weight. No, he doesn't. I've seen more people get tossed because they let their horse forget they were up there, and then they ambushed them or scared them. Of course, Smokey's coming to camera, so the camera moves. Smokey's gonna rub on the leg. So, when a horse, when, what was I talking about? She wouldn't listen. She was talking.
I don't know.
She was talking to Kitty. Hell, I forgot what I was talking about. Horse pressure. Oh, a horse forgets you're on his back. So what happens when a horse forgets you're on his back, you scare him. I've seen people, that's why a lot of people say don't let your horse eat. Because if you let him eat, you get relaxed up there, you're not paying attention. The horse kind of forgets you're up there, he's eating, he goes into grazing mode. And next thing you know, when you move or pull on the rein, you scare him and he's like, what the hell? I forgot somebody was on my back. You got to remind a horse you're there and you give him direction. When a horse gets scared, I have to refocus that fear so he doesn't just concentrate on that fear. If Mr. T is scared of this blanket, and I scare him with this blanket, and he's scared, I just hold it right here and I freeze. All he's got to worry about is blanket and his pressure building, and he's like, I gotta run, my instincts tells him move, I shouldn't stand here, should I fight, should I kick? His mind's going all in his blanket. But if I hold a blanket here and I see that, and I go, hey buddy, pay attention to me. And he gives me his head, I refocus his attention from his blanket to me. I made him drop his head. I made him come forward. I made him move his feet. Now he can't concentrate on his fear. That's what I say, make sure you're an active rider. You don't have to nag him all the time and be in his face, because that's bad. But is he kicking the blanket?
I'm gonna grab the cat.
Smokey, we're gonna smoke you for dinner, boy. So be aware of that. When you're on your horse's back, rubbing them, maybe just moving the reins a little bit, adjusting your weight. Watch your horse's eyes. Watch their ears. Make sure every once in a while they give you an ear. Make sure out of the side of their face they kind of see you, catch eye contact. Be aware that your horse may, if you get totally disconnected and you get on a phone and get in a conversation and you totally leave your horse alone, his mind's going to start turning. He's going to be on his own. You don't want a horse on his own, because when he's on his own and he reacts, he goes instinctive. What does he do when he's instinctive? He bucks to get the crazy predator off his back so he doesn't get eaten. He tries to run as fast as he can to cover, and if he can't run, he can't get the predator off, he fights. And that's when a horse flips over, or, you know, and you don't cause a horse pain when he's going instinctual. That's why I think bits are bad, because when a horse gets mad, people want to yank on a bit and pop and do all that crap and cause pain. When a horse is in fear mode and he gets pain, it's a lot shorter trip to fight mode. But you can't tell people that, because bits are nice and kind and rubber, and my horse loves it, and Black Beauty, who had a bit, I don't, whatever. I know, Mr. T. So, anyway, what's the time?
18 minutes.
18?
Yeah.
Okay. As long as I don't get to 30, then YouTube gives me a pain in the butt. Okay, so, what was the other thing I want to talk about? The pressure release on the kid. Basically, I just messed with the kid back and forth a few times. I was just playing with him, and after a while, I felt sorry for the mom, because she was like, what is wrong with you? Because she didn't have a clue. Oh, Rick's picking on women again. Of course she didn't have a clue. She's paying for her bill in a checkout line. She doesn't know there's some crazy horse guy behind her doing pressure and release on her kid. Of course she didn't have a clue. I'm not saying she's stupid. I'm just saying she didn't have a clue, and she kept looking at the kid. Why are you doing that? You know what? Had she looked at the kid like I tell you to look at your horse, look at the environment, she would have figured out why the kid was doing it and what was causing it. But she didn't, because she was preoccupied with paying her bill, collecting her things and doing her stuff and wanted to get out of there. And again, she didn't know the crazy horse guy was behind her. So don't be aware that when your horse does something, you go, what the, why is that crazy horse? Something's going on. Figure out why. Can you control what's going on, or can you not? If you can't control it, then help your horse deal with it. If you know what's causing it, you can help him deal with it. What was the other thing I want to talk about here? There was a study out that says once you figure out, hi Smokey, once you figure out something and you think you've either mastered it or you've got a good handle on it, you stop processing information. And they did this study and they kind of made people semi-experts in a certain field, and they refused to accept new data because they felt comfortable where they're at. And that's how you get these horse people who are into certain massage, or they follow somebody, or they worship somebody, and they're like, everybody else is wrong, this person works. When you stop processing data, you stop growing and you stop learning. They also found in this study, you're only willing to accept new data that confirms your original belief. Now, that happens all the time in the horse world. If I say something and somebody hates me, they are going to say that's the worst information, etc. And if they're a Pat Pirelli fan and Pat Pirelli says it next week, they're going to go, yeah, Pat knows, man, that's great, Pat's great. It's people put their filters on either who they like or don't like, or the information either confirms their beliefs or they don't want to hear it. And if they don't want to hear it, they discount it. When they discount it, they stop growing. They stop learning. You failure to progress. People do that with horses and horse information and horse trainers. We all do it. Stupid humans do it everywhere. It's just how we are. We kind of want to confirm. People in the same religion want to hang out with people that believe the way they do. People with the same political affiliation kind of want to hang out with people with the same. They just don't want to fight and try to convince everybody all the time. You might do it a little while, but it gets old. It's just easier to kind of hang out with the people that kind of agree with you. Now, people will call that racism. If white people hang out together and black people hang out together, they go, oh, they're racist. They're just comfortable with their own kind, that they have the same beliefs, they have the same backgrounds. They feel comfortable. You put horses in there, I say horses are racist all the time. You put three black horses, three white horses out there, I guarantee you the three white horses will be together and the three black ones will be together. You look at cattle out in the field, if there's all black cattle and there's a couple white ones, they will usually be off by themselves, all the black ones will be together. It's just nature that drives us to things that kind of confirm, reassure, make us feel normal, make us feel it makes us feel better. So when you're with horses, be aware of that. Be aware that you kind of stop information and you block it. It makes you more of a critical thinker. It makes you accept things that you may normally would say, you know what, that doesn't fit in my box. I don't like it, I'm not gonna try it. Like using a bit. If you once you've been taught a bit and you got safety from a bit, getting past that safety and going to a rope halter just seems like this huge big deal. But I get 50 letters a month from people that went to a rope halter and tell me their horse is happier, they're calmer, they feel better, they never knew how much bad the bit did. Those are the same people that probably 6 months ago were telling me, you can't control a horse with a bit, they'll run off, they're crazy, you need a bit. A bit is helpful, a bit's not mean, a bit just gives direction. A bit is pain, people. Quit being a dummy, repeating what you hear. What's my time, Holly?
23 minutes.
Let's see. Now, this is the other thing that I kind of thought was kind of interesting. I don't know when people come to me, whether they want help or whether they want to feel good. Because if you want to feel good, you're coming to the wrong place, okay? And I guess the correlation of that, and I made a note of the other day, if I stop and ask somebody, I'm lost, and I got to get somewhere and I'm lost, and I stop and ask for directions, and the person that gives me directions is an asshole like Rick Gore. And he's just like, well, you dummy, all you had to do was turn back here. Shit, if you couldn't see that sign, it was as big as this. It said turn right to the airport. You're going the wrong way. You got to go that way, you big dummy. Are you really going to go, I don't like the way he gave me the directions. I'm going to go away from the airport. I'm just going to drive the wrong way and keep going down the wrong freaking road because I didn't like the way he gave me the directions. Of course you're not, unless you're a freaking idiot. You're going to go, you know what, that guy could have been nicer, I didn't like what he said, but you know what, it was good directions, it got me to the airport quicker, it saved me time, saved me gas, I got here in time. I didn't like the guy, but he gave me good directions. Look, you ain't got to like me, I'd prefer it if you didn't like me, because then you wouldn't be emailing me and bugging me. I like it when you don't like me. People go, you know, you get more people liking you if you were nice. I don't want people liking me, leave me alone. Use the information to help your horse, use the information to grow, give your horse a better life. It's going to keep you safer. It's going to make the horse world better. Every person I change or get to look at something different, other people see them and they're kind of want to be like them. Maybe. Unless they're just stubborn barn witches that are like, they're dangerous. They're in a rope halter. they're listening to that crazy Rick Gore guy. They're crazy. They're going to be dead. Okay. People have been riding rope halters since the beginning of horses, but all of a sudden, because we have bits now, now everybody needs a bit because you're a dummy. All right. We'll end that there. Hopefully that helped. I don't know what I'll call this, but you'll know it when you see the title. Buddy, Mr. T, I'm sorry. You guys, like dads are being a jerk today. All right. We'll end that there. Buddy, Mr.